Hi, my name is Steve Kinney, and I'm the head of engineering for front-end developer tools at Temporal. Enterprise UI development is a course on how to make sure your code base stays maintainable over a long period of time with a wide range of contributors and a large team. In this course, we'll take a comprehensive look at testing, from the smallest unit tests to component tests from multiple frameworks to browser-based integration tests using Playwright. We'll also look at strategies to keep your tests maintainable over the long term. Most importantly, we'll look at how to automate all of this using GitHub Actions. Finally, we'll discuss some patterns for structuring your application and proposing changes now that you have a solid foundation to build on top of. Thank you so much, and I hope you enjoy this course. The core questions that we are going to look at is, how do we create maintainable code bases? I think a lot about when I started at my current job, one of the super duper senior distributed system engineers went like, front end architect, what is that? Right? And it made me think a little bit about like, what does it mean for a front end app to scale? Right? Because like a database might have a million users, 100,000 users slamming at it, right? Your front-end application, generally speaking, they download the code into their one browser. And sure, it could be Internet Explorer or Safari, depending on the year. But generally speaking, like the idea of like a million people using it is not necessarily going to have a larger effect than one or two, depending on like other than the breadth of the different situations that they're using it in. So the way that I kind of explained the like plight of maintaining a large front-end code base, as I was like, you know how on the back end y'all like to break everything into very small microservices that don't know anything about anything and are totally isolated and encapsulated? He's like, yeah. I'm like, my job is to hide that from our customers, right? They should never know that you did that, right? And so the way I think that a lot of times a large front-end code base tends to fall apart is not necessarily that it goes down like a database, right, or stops taking requests. It's usually that it slowly erodes and like kind of like in like physics, like everything tends towards entropy, which is like chaos, right? It slowly erodes to the fact that one like what should have been a 1-point ticket or a 3-point ticket, right? A relatively easy thing to do. Everyone's like, I don't know, that might take 2 weeks, right? Because we don't know what'll break. And every time you like try to like push something in production, someone's pager goes off, right? Insofar that we build these like large, like stateful applications, the way that they tend to like break down on us is that they become so complex and so complicated and so chaotic that they become almost impossible to maintain. And that's when people start whispering about the rewrite. And I've done the rewrite. The rewrite never goes well, right? Like, it's just a new opportunity to make the same mistakes and start the process over again, but you will end up back there as well. And that is kind of what we are seeking in our time together, in this course, is to basically figure out how, to the best of our ability, how do we kind of, like, manage that chaos and keep it under control. And kind of as I thought about it more and more, there are kind of like the three levels, and this pyramid is like designed after like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which is like, first, have the systems in place, right? If you don't have like the systems, then like you can wax poetic from your ivory tower about the best way to structure an application, it doesn't really matter. Also, you can like talk about it over lunch, but unless you actually have a process for like getting the team on board and all of those kinds of things, then like it doesn't matter either because it's just like your thoughts. And so like those patterns, those kind of like belief systems and how do we structure an application are like sit on the foundation of like, do you have a system that keeps everyone honest about that? And do you have a process for kind of collaboration? Otherwise those parts don't really matter. And so we will spend a lot of time focusing on the systems because one, that's the most objective. Right, everyone's code bases can be a little bit different. But we will, when possible, kind of talk about the processes and the patterns. To our point that like, we can write so many less tests now that we have TypeScript. It would be nice to have TypeScript validate that things were okay too. The easiest way to do that for most setups these days is to just run the build process. Well, that must be why he called it build and test. And so like we can basically try to add another step to this script, right, that also tries to build the application. That will expose any kind of like TypeScript issues as well, and will allow us to see that as well. And so we want to just add another run command to not only do npm test, but then also do like a npm run build. So you can see we have jobs, and then this is kind of like, think about this as a JavaScript object. This is the key. The value is everything kind of nested in here, right? And so we will start with everyone's good friend, copy and paste. And what we will do is, now we have two keys that are the same, so we will call this one unit test. And we'll take out the build part. And we'll call this one build. And we'll take out the test part. Cool. So steps run sequentially, which kind of makes sense given the name. Jobs and workflows run in parallel. Cool, so you can see I've got that little dot right there, which is saying like, cool, they haven't completed yet, and they're queued and they're waiting to run. But if we go into the details now, you'll see that there are two here. If I go, no, I wanted to go to summary. I'm sorry, I lied to you. We go, yeah, you can see that it doesn't like visually look like they're running in parallel because it looked like a list just like the other list, but this list is running in parallel. And if like one thing relied on another thing, you would start to see it go this way for like the sequential steps. And parallel in this case is straight down. So you can see build already finished. Unit test is still running. And we can kind of begin to put that all in place. Now, if you did to kind of like begin to spiritually answer the question, we'll do this a little bit deeper when we look at like even one of mine. If you do have like one that depends on another one, you can say like, you can get very like nuanced with the dependencies, right? And so like you could say something along the lines, this could be pseudocode. You could say that build needs unit test, right? And now build won't run until unit test is successful. Right. So theoretically, could you have a job that installs the dependencies one place and then everything else like rely on it? You could. You might choose to. With two, it's like you don't even know which one was going to finish first. Right. So now we're saying that one doesn't start without the other one. There are ways to speed some of this up that are more useful than having to rely. But you can also say like unit test and like some other action, and now both of those need to complete before that one kicks off. Or you can have two different ones that are relying on the same first one. So you can like play with your dependency manifests in interesting ways, and you can get nuanced with that. But we're not gonna do that just yet. I need sanity around my app because I'm tired of getting paged, and I need to do this big refactor, and I need to put some of this stuff in place ASAP. Right, and I understand the trade-offs from unit tests all the way through. I'm here for it. I think one of the most powerful things that you can do with this is you've got record at cursor and record new. Let's do record new, that way I don't have to worry about where my cursor is. And it spins up a browser. We will go to localhost 3000. And like, would you want to maybe just change that to the slash? Probably. Right, if you had the base URL set. There are little things you might want to tweak, but go in here, click on that, type in, we want a Charizard, is that what we wanted before? Charizard, we'll click that, we'll see it rendered on the page. There's not a lot of other stuff to click, so let's go over to secret menu. You could literally spin this up, just drive through your entire app in one mega test, right? Just in terms of the sanity check, we'll go we'll pick KFC, secret. This, by the way, when I talk about like things that I do when I should be working on my workshop, finding a data set for all of the secret menu items at all the fast food restaurants and then massaging and parsing that data into a table and then building stupid rating sliders is a thing that I did. Right, because that was the best use of my time. And yeah, the fact that those table divs scroll, That didn't happen on its own. And what else could we do? We go in here, let's go sign up for an account. I have made so many weird email addresses. And I get the feedback of what everything is. Let's say live coding, because there's definitely no way that I did that earlier, at gmail.com. This doesn't send any emails.
Is a scrollable table div accessible?
I have no idea. This is mostly, I wonder if table divs can scroll.
I
want to
do that
scroll
at work, but I don't think the accessibility team would like that. Ooh, tough.
The best part is I was talking. I don't even remember what email and password I used, but luckily, if you look over to the right, this entire test is being recorded. So I could theoretically look at my own thing. Okay, there's some stuff in the database over here. I would really like to see what I'm doing here. So we can go ahead. I can write a new thing, which is restarting computers is the best. Hit enter. There it is. This is in case I wanted to tweet and I have something stupid to say. I can just write it in this app, and everything's fine. Update it, give it maybe an exclamation point or two. Oh, maybe not. Like, I found a bug in my app, right? I can't edit that. We'll go close out then. We will sign out. I don't know. Go whatever you want to do. I think I've made my point. So then we can go back here and we can hit cancel. And what you see is possibly the ramblings of a madman. But in a lot of ways, effectively a test that does cover a lot of my app, right? And gives me, at least in terms of like, hey, is this thing doing the thing? Like, is it running? Can I navigate around? Am I seeing the things I'm supposed to see? Right? Would I do that much without maybe pausing and like doing a few expectations every once in a while? I probably would. There are things that you need to fill in, like in my experience, and it might just be like my bad coding, but I had to change some of these to type. I would probably, it also helps me figure out where my locators are less than ideal. That's because there should be a no dash in between those two, right? So also useful, also like a great sanity check, because I didn't even know that I made that boo-boo. You would have watched me try to type and not have it not work. You know, I changed this to just a slash, so on and so forth. You know, all sorts of stuff. There was just random stuff that when I didn't really know what password I was going to use. There you go. Wow.
I noticed shocker. You had deleted one of your passwords. Looks like that line 19 there, right above your cursor, meta plus A. Is that like a delete key?
That's command A for select all.
Older. Oh,
yeah. Right.
And then you just typed over it. I see.
Yep. Yeah, I was talking. I was like, I wonder how many letters I hit. I don't remember. Let me start over. Right. So yeah, you would probably do some cleaning up here. But in terms of like verifying that all the stuff in place, can you click these things? Can you navigate and stuff along those lines? Like, this will get you a lot of bang for a relatively small buck.